Thank you very much indeed. Can I first of all say thank you for inviting me back to Hilton? Well, I love all the heat your heart out. Hilton does it far better, doesn't it? Let's get on with the show. It's a great event marking the centenary of our Armistice Day. I think all week you'll have seen it gathering and building as we celebrate the ending of the war. Okay, we open with a song from the 1985 Gilbert and Sullivan opera, The Mikado, singing Three Little Maids from School Are We. It's Sue Hay, Yvonne Wright and Richard Dunn. Come around, go boss.
Lorn lad, son of the king, who had run away from home to escape a marriage to an older king. He falls hopelessly in love with a beautiful maid from a humble part of town, who returns the love of the itinerant young man. The young maid is one of three sisters who have just been released from school and are joyfully singing their way home. But one sister is ecstatically happy. Can you guess which one? No prizes for guessing it. Right, of course. But do enjoy this rendition of Three Little Maids from the musical The Mikado.
Gershwin keeps pounding on tin. Out Harlow
Strauss, which was a Gershwin number. So from a wonderful song like that, we now move on to some wonderful works. I bet this week for a lot of people have been very emotional, and I think tissues may be out after these words. Can I introduce you to Ken Attwood?
Family in October 1917. At the time, he was in a hospital bed in Salonika, where he'd been recovering from wounds for nearly 2 months. Behind the trenches in the Balkans, as the sun is sinking low, with tramp and creep and jingle, I see the gun tunes go, and sometimes seems to remind me, as a dreaming I lay, of my own dear Hilton village at the quiet end of the day. Brown thatch in golden blooming, with lily and the roses, and the cool breeze of the evening, pleasant as it flows, with fields of wheat and barley, with flowers as they foam, and the sky red with sunset, as the lads are going home. Home, lads, home, all along the fields of clover. Home, lads, home, when the working day's over. Oh, there's the rest of men and horses, when the honest day is done, and they go home together at the setting of the sun. Old pals, when the work is over, I see them all so plain, with flag and baskets nodding, as they tramp the leafy lane. There's the birds somewhere calling, and the swallows flying low, as the lads go tramping homeward, singing as they go. Well, gone is many a lad now, and many miles too, to fight in our country's battles, in lands we never knew. Out in terrible climates of heat, to fight the foe, on the red road to victory, are shouting as they go. Dear lads and wounded also, I see them just the same. I see them and I know them, and name them each by name. Some I hope to meet again, and talk of days gone by, but finish this job we must do, at any rate we'll try. Then it will be home, home, with sunlight on our faces, home lads, home, to the quiet happy places. Oh, what a rest for men and horses, when the long, hard fight is won, and we'll all go home together at the setting of the sun.
Thank you, Ken. Well, as you can see, it's quite flexible this afternoon. I'm getting new itineraries as I speak. Right, so now we're in for a drilling. Oh, what a lovely war.
Long way to Tipperary, but my heart lies there. so bad.
Go admire.
I'm not to knock this over.
Upon the seat of a bicycle, for two.
You have to listen carefully. We have got very, very special people for you. We have got Lucy, age 10.
Thank you.
so as I said, we're going to finish with the first one we did again, because, you know, the favourites. So do please join in. The first verse is a kind of instrumental to bring you in. Yeah? So if you join in, we'll be starting.
Welcome to the St. Neots Handbell Ringers.
I'd like to thank you very much. We, as you see, don't travel very light. We hope to take some moment to meet you. Also, Jane on my right here has literally flown in from America and landed 3 hours ago. Thank you. Our next piece is perhaps quite familiar to you. The Lamb of War. Just sort of muddle around some bells. And do feel free to sing along if you recognise the tune at all.
Get everybody up to hunting.
Thank you.
This time we're going to use our top bells as well as one of the lower bells. So I'm sure you'll recognise this. He's called Pomp and Circumstance. There is a bit of squash in this one.
Thank you.
please don't try dancing with us. We will try and keep it at a distance.
They do a great job getting two tables, seven people, 100 bells, four music stands onto this stage. Well done. Thank you, Esther. on stage, Julie Briggs and Ian Stott. There's a hole in somebody's bucket.
Oh. Has anybody here seen Henry? No. Have you seen Henry? He's not that tall. I'm wearing a straw hat. I need him to fetch some water. Have you seen him?
With what should I put it, dear Liza? With what should I put it, dear
Helen, Sue, Pauline and Margaret.
My name is Jenny
on our wedding day, we received a lot of telegrams. And some of the people in the audience might imagine the telegrams. Yes, a lot of people have never seen telegrams. I thought that was good. These were just the ordinary cheekbone ones that you got. And then, we got an even posher version. And then, we got something like this. That was the first class one. And you can imagine some of the interesting marks we had in the telegrams in our survey. Some of you may know me as a great granny that dashes around the village. Not by the sunny women putting on top, but rather mobility scooter with flowers on top. And I know some of the gentlemen are a little concerned because when it's windy they think I might tip over. But I can reassure you with my weight and stabilizers I'm perfectly safe. my late husband's initials were Stott. And he frequently had to deal with people in America. I remember this when they phoned, because he had a good sense of humour. He'd say, "Hey, Stott, speaking." After the film, you can imagine that gave him a load of giggles. And he had although I think something along the lines of that's what attracted me in the first place. And then they said to him, "Please keep talking, we'd love to hear your voice." Which of course he did, he replied. Anyway, that's enough about me. And now, basically, there's children. Now, I can't see many children. Perhaps they're hiding somewhere. But I want them. I'm not going to tell you the title of what I'm going to read. And I would like perhaps from the children to try and guess what it should be on my piece of paper. Oh, thank you. Sorry, I thought they were coming. There's a famous seaside place called Blackpool that's noted for fresh air and fun. And Mr. and Mrs. Ramsbottom went there with young Albert, their son. A grand little lad was young Albert, and dressed in his best, quite as well. With a stick, with an horse's head and handle, the finest that were bullets could sell. They didn't think much of the ocean, the waves they were fiddling those smalls. There were no wrecks, and nobody drowned. In fact, nothing to laugh at all. So seeking for further amusement, they paid and went into the zoo, where they had lions and tigers and camels, and old ale and sandwiches too. There were one great big lion called Wallace. His nose were all covered in scars. He lay in a somnolent posture, with the side of his face on the bars. Now Albert had heard about lions, how they were ferocious and wild. To see Wallace lying so peaceful, well, it didn't seem right to the child. So straightway the brave little fella, not showing a morsel of fear, took his stick with his horse's head and handle and pushed it in Wallace's ear. You could see that the lion didn't like it. Giving a kind of a roll, he pulled Albert inside the cage with him and swallowed the little lad whole. Then Pa, who'd seen the occurrence and didn't know what to do next, said, "Mother, yon lion's that Albert." And Mother said, "Well, I'm vexed." Then Mr. and Mrs. Ramsbottom, when all said and done, complain to the animal kingdom that the lion had eaten their son. The keeper was quite nice about it and said, "What a nasty mistake. Are you sure it's your boy he's eaten?" Tar said, "I'm not sure. Where's his gout?" The manager had to be sent for, and he came and said, "What's to do?" Tar said, "Young lion says Albert, and him in his Sunday clothes too." The mother said, right, young man, I think it's a shame and a sin for a lion to go and meet Albert and not be paid to come in." The manager wanted no trouble. He took out his purse right away. "Hey, how much to settle the matter?" The Pa said, "What do you usually pay?" But mother had turned a bit awkward when she thought where her Albert had gone. She said, "No, someone's got to be summoned." So that was decided upon. Then off they went to the police station in front of the magistrate chap. They told him what had happened to Albert and proved it by showing his cap. The magistrate gave his opinion that no one was really to blame and said that he hoped the Ramsbottoms would have further sons to their name. At that, mother got proper blazing. "And thank you, sir, kindly," said she. "What, waste all our lives raising children to feed ruddy lions? Not me." Now, did any of the children guess the title? Come on, someone might have had the title. Anyone in there? What do you think the title was? Yes? For the lion and... Albert, right. Come see what's in my bag. A lion bar. But you won't eat anything until you ask your parents if you're allowed to eat it and if you're allowed to share it with any of your friends. This is the trouble when you have to have a walking stick and you can't jump down. I used to be able to.
Thank you, Jenny. Another round of applause for Jenny. Thank you. Now, those of you who are from Hilton, you'll know that this building has quite a lot of history itself. The extension was opened, I think, by a serving Prime Minister. And this building here, the original part, was actually Hilton School 100 years ago for all ages, including two teachers. But to take this further, I'm going to hand over to Donna, who's going to narrate this story.
You don't need my
Is that right, Colin?
That's right, yeah. Possibly.
On that step over there. Mother, children, there's a head moving, I can see there. Now take this in carefully, children. I'm going to read you the school rules. I find it necessary to do that. First of all, children must attend school regularly. Saturday, as you know, is a whole holiday. Hair must be neatly cut and combed. Come and see me later, that girl. This one in particular is very important. Hands and face must be clean and clothes mended at all times. Girls in particular must be neat and without any finery. And if boys wear frocks on Sundays, they must be clean. Are you listening, boys? Every offence against good order or good morals of any kind will be strictly punished. Thank you, you may carry on. Now, is there a form I should fill in? Or should I speak to the paper or the chairman of managers? I simply had no alternative to send Leonard Beck home today. He had such a dirty face and was so unhappy. He would have been such a bad example to all the other children.
What do you mean, sending my Leonard home like that?
I beg your pardon.
He's only got a dirty face.
Dare you burst in here like this?
He has. He's got. I know he's got hand-me-down clothes and all that, but he can't help that. I've got nine children. Nine children. Look after in the morning, and I can't do it.
Mrs. Beck, I intend to follow the rules of the school to the letter. It clearly says here.
I don't see why his education should suffer just because he got a dirty face.
But why haven't you brought him back? Where is the boy?
He's not coming today.
What? No, not coming today. But where is he? Why haven't you brought him back?
He's not coming today.
But I don't understand.
I can't get any water. Of course the village pumps. I don't have any soap.
Well, in that case, Mrs. Beck, I have an idea. I will ask Mrs. Super, the vicar's wife, to bring you some of my own soap and water and a face cloth so that he may be clean and tidy. Come to school tomorrow. Now, but Mrs. Beck, I cannot have you walking in here like this, shouting at me. There are procedures, you know. Do you understand?
We may not have much, but we've got our car. Come on.
Never been so good to insult.
I might not send him back, ever.
Oh, I'm definitely going to have to report this to the chairman of managers.
It's about time somebody told her what's what. Come on, Vera. Let's carve up the bread. You can put the dripping on.
Thank you, Carol, Kath, Caitlin, and Donna. I think we now have Ken back. Do you want me to give an introduction, Ken? The story? Okay, welcome back, Ken.
This is a poem that I wrote this week. And it's entitled, Take the Price to Be Away. The guns have all gone silent now, and the trenches are empty of men. So please don't stand and forget me, because I gave everything I could back then. The gas masks are redundant and in museums now, and the bayonets are all safely tucked away. So please don't walk past my grave and not remember just what I gave. The cannons and tanks are all scrap metal. No more shells will leave them now. So please don't forget me, anyone else. You gave everything you could. The battlefields lie silent and wave, with poppies so vibrant in red. Those poppies are fed with the blood of men who paid the ultimate price. 100 years have passed this way, and still those poppies wave. So that each of us that remain and are safe can remember this food in our graves.
Thank you, Ken. And to finish off this first hour, before we have a 5 minute interval, is a song from the truly amazingly emotional musical Les Miserables. We have Christian Turner singing Bring Him Home. First half then. I think we have a 7 minute break, is it? their section that marked the ending of the First World War. So, on my visit, now the music off.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present to you a few songs from the time of the Great War, which began in 1914, which they thought would be all over by Christmas that year. There was a famous truce on the battlefield. And of course, it wasn't, as we all know. Now, what was I going to say then? I should have had the words with me. It dragged on for another four years. And millions of lives were lost. Hostilities ceased officially with the signing of the armistice on the 11th of November 1918, 100 years ago today. These songs, some of which were sung in France and wherever the troops fought from 1914, or our version of them, and some which were sung at home to encourage the men to enlist and to raise the morale of those left behind when the troops were away, bring back, as nothing else can, thoughts of days we should never forget, and images of people, the men who fought, and the many who never returned home. Trivial, many of these songs may seem, they are history. They are like no other songs. They are forever associated with this particular period in our history. When we sing them, we find ourselves striving, carrying on. Fury. That's the word. My friend. And when people tell you that the army's not complete, it goes to show that they don't know. I say the army's to be perfect, can't be beat. I know it's true. How do I know? Because it's like things I do. Sometime back, to me, things weren't all they ought to be. There was one, I think, that was wanted, only one, and of course that thing was done.
What's up is all right, it's all right now. You don't need to worry anymore. I saw the army was a strong, everything was wrong till the day it came along, and then the band played.
Ask me why, Dolly Gray. There's a murmur in the air, you can hear it everywhere. It is time to do or dare, Dolly Gray. And you hear the tramp of feet, Dolly Gray, sailing through the village street, Dolly Gray. Is the tramp of soldiers' feet in their uniform so neat? Goodbye and you'll be me, Dolly Gray. Goodbye, Dolly, I must leave you. Dolly Briggs, my love.
one changed everything, plain and simple. But in so many ways, the changes it brought about involved not only the scores of men who fought and died in the trenches, but the women who held the fort down at home. It is important to remember that the world before the war saw women as primarily mothers, wives and daughters. They were gentle creatures whose fears in the home and whose thoughts were best expressed through the men in their lives. Women knew that they were perfectly capable of taking charge. It wasn't until war swept through the world that they were given a chance to show that. Prior to the war, so many women out there didn't work and devoted their whole lives to their husbands, and most especially their children. Women stepped into all sorts of jobs that the men had left behind. Suddenly, that was gone. Torn away by a war that so many women opposed, especially the suffragettes, who violently opposed the war. During this time, women could vote. This year is the 100th anniversary of the suffragettes, and a very important one for women.
Thank you.
Here comes a whiz bang. What? Here comes a whiz bang. Now you soldiers get down the stairs. Don't eat your dugouts and say your prayers. Ah. Here comes a whiz bang. And it's making straight for you. And you see all the wonders of no man's land if a whiz bang gets you. Watching by the poplars, clarinet in eyes. She's watching and longing and waiting where the long white roadway lies. And a song stirs in the silence as the wind in the boughs above. She listens and starts and trembles. It's the first little song of love. Roses are shining in Picardy, in the heart of the silver dew. Roses are flowering in Picardy, but there's never a rose like you. And the roses will die in the summer sun, and a rose that you fall upon. But there's one rose that dies not in Picardy. It's a rose that I keep in my heart.
Mademoiselle from Armitage, hallelujah. Mademoiselle from Armitage, say to you. Who's a lady for a job? There's a way to shoulder on.
Amid the guns below, we are dead. short days ago, we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders field. Take up our quarrel, love. To you, from failing hands, we throw the torch. Be yours to hold it high. Ye break faith with us who die. We shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields.
Up to your waist in water, up to your eyes in slush. Using the kind of language to make the sergeant blush. Who would join the army? That's what we all admire. Don't you pity the poor civilian sitting beside the fire? Oh, 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 it's a lovely war.
And also a special thanks to Helen and Margaret and all the team that helped come here today as well. And I think, Penny, did you say you want to say a few words?
Women have worked so hard to prepare this ritual this afternoon. You wouldn't believe how many weeks they put it together. Jill, Margaret, Joan. It was just too many people to mention. And we'd just like to put their hands together and say thank you very much for all they did.
You can have that cup of tea. And then it's down to the beacon. Yes, Margaret?
What?
Yes? Enjoy the rest of the afternoon.
They're all around the country. They're 19...
Not until 7 o'clock, they're not.
Oh. A bit premature.
Thank you.
Yeah.